Namaste, poker homies. Navanada, no limit hold'em. Today I'm going to bring you another little mini presentation here about a specific hand. This is based off of a specific hand I played. I made it a little bit more general than what it actually was, but just to have a, I don't know, a broader appeal or to make it more relatable. But for the sake of argument, let's just say we're playing at the local casino, and this is a $1, $2, no limit hold'em live cash game. Full ring. Now, also I wanted to mention, this is an idea, or a demonstration of a piece of an idea that I have for kind of a new, I think new, form of poker instructional medium, or media. So, I'd really appreciate it if I got some comments about, oh, what you think about this as a potential, I don't know what you'd even call it, but just a poker instructional thing, you know. So my idea is that, well, one of the ideas is to set up an entire tournament, like where you go through every single hand, one hand at a time, every decision point, one decision point at a time. And if you're familiar with like Choose Your Own Adventure, I think it would have something like that, like almost like a game aspect to it. Because you'd kind of be making the decisions that you thought were right and going down that, well, that rabbit hole and seeing how that ends up with commentary along the way. So, just an idea, but I hope, and it'll make more sense once you see this video, or especially if you've seen some of the other more recent videos that I've done that kind of have the same format. But I'm going to use a very linear I'm going to go through this in a linear fashion, but just something to note is you wouldn't even have to do that. I mean, you could just bounce from the summary first and see if whatever the summary is something like that you think is important. And then if it is, you can go back and pay it, go back to the beginning. Or you could see, like, you know, if you get to this point here and you want to go back and see, like, now why is he doing this here? Did I miss something back here? You can do that, but this is just for presentation mode. I'm just going to click through it, kind of one frame at a time, in order. So here we go. I think maybe I'll just read off of the screen, maybe there'll be some other things to mention, but let's get started. So we've got ace-king suited, full ring cash game, live, $1, $2, no limit hold'em. okay, so one of the things, oh, here I go presenting. I'm supposed to just be reading the slide. So, okay, who did what from where? I think your job is primarily to pay attention. I mean, you do your off-table work and learn how to play poker and learn how to think about poker when you're not playing poker. That's your job when you're outside the game, is to get better at playing poker. When you're inside the game, your primary responsibility is just to pay attention to what's going on, and to think one decision point at a time. So your job in game is primarily to pay attention. So what does it mean? What are we paying attention to? We're paying attention to who? No Limit Hold'em has been described as hours of boredom with moments of terror. This can't be the game you play. You've got to pay attention to which players have what tendencies and what propensities. Maybe our villain is a live, low-stakes, tight, aggressive player who only plays strong hands and always opens for a raise. Maybe he limps his big hands and only open raises a capped and bounded range. If we don't know who our opponent is, how can we exploit his weaknesses? So in this situation, villain is a senior citizen who plays very few hands, well, plays few hands, and limps more often than he raises. We've seen him continuation bet 100% of the time when he had the opportunity to, but we've seen him play honest, or apparently honest, on later streets. We think he's tight and passive in general. Some things just to note, we know that he does have an open limping range, and we have seen him get aggressive in position, so he's probably positionally aware. So when we're paying attention to what are we paying attention to? Well, what has the action been up to this point in hand? You need to notice as much as you can notice and be constantly analyzing your opponents, trying to get a feel for the type of player they are and how they might think about the game. Anytime you find yourself bored or daydreaming, Try to remember that you are at work and you get paid to pay attention. We are playing a live low-stakes cash game with 100 big blinds effective stacks, facing an open raise of 6 times the big blind. Okay. Without much deliberation, Villain opens for his standard raise size of $12. Okay. So that's what happened. Where? Okay, in no limp hold'em position is king. Our villain in the hand raised from under the gun. First position. Someone has a hand. Moving along. Okay. Tight passive villain open raises to $12 from under the gun. We hold ace of spades, king of spades on the button. So the action folds to us. What's our plan? So should we raise our ace king suited? If your opponent has a strong range of open raising hands, and if he will fold his weakest hands to a 3-bet, how much good does it do us to 3-bet this hand? If we 3-bet and villain is out of line or just near the bottom of his range, then we may as well have two napkins. If we 3-bet and get called, we will be up against a pretty strong range. The ace-king is not a big favorite against. If we face a 4-bet from the tight passive player who opened under the gun and got 3-bet, what are we going to do? Don't waste a hand this strong turning it into a bluff. If you are hoping to generate fold equity, use something like ace-5 suited that's not strong enough to flat. Call. Our hand plays very well post-flop and will dominate some of the hands in our opponent's range like king-queen suited and ace-jack. It will dominate some of the hands that villain may have folded to a 3-bet like ace-10 and king-jack. Flatting this hand is going to be deceptive in that villains won't give us credit for an ace and king as pre-flop caller and may decide to bluff our improvement cards. We will be able to float some flops and make some decent to high equity light raises pre-flop. If villain was in later position and or not a nit, we wouldn't flat this hand pre-flop. A call does a lot of good things for us, and honestly, raising maybe wastes the value of our hand. Keep villain's range wide and play post-flop poker in position with a strong hand. What about fold? It's absolutely out of the question. Your hand is at parity with most even nitty pre-flop raising ranges and will be ahead of most open raising ranges even from under the gun. The question should be, if I raise, will villain call with worse and preferably dominated hands? And will villain fold better, preferably dominated hands? Dominant hands. If the answer is no to both of those questions, then you should think long and hard before doing anything but flat calling. This is especially true when you're in position. Okay, so next, hero decides to flat call ace king suited on the button. Let's take a flop. The flop is queen of spades, nine of clubs, two of diamonds. Villain makes a continuation bet of $15 into $27. What's our play? So we've got ace of spades, king of spades. The board is queen of spades, nine of clubs, two of diamonds. Two over cards, backdoor straight draw, backdoor flush draw. Backdoor nut straight and backdoor nut flush draw. So do we want to fold? Villain is a nit with a strong pre-flop range. We miss the flop and he's continuing to aggress with a standard looking continuation bet of about half the pot. However, we do have position, two over cards, a backdoor nut flush draw, runner runner Broadway, and we have a good idea of how our opponent plays. If you know villain doesn't see that bluff, you can fold. Otherwise, we can do something, right? What about call? We don't flat ace-king suited preflop in position to fold two over cards and two backdoor nut draws. You will pick up enough equity to continue on the turn even if he does bet again, and you may even find a spot to bluff raise. If villain checks the turn, very likely since he raised preflop and is heads up, we can try to take him off his hand. If the ace or king comes, we could catch him bluffing our cards or overplaying a dominated top pair. Raise? I do like this a little bit. Our opponent is a tight player who is likely to just be making a standard c-bet with his entire range. The thing is, we don't need to risk the extra money here. We're in position, and we'll get to see if he slows down on the turn, and we could pick up equity and continue even if he fires again. If we flatted ace-king suited from the big blind, I could see some arguments for raising here, though maybe we would just fold. But as it is, I think we have a great spot to float the flop and use our position, equity, and reads on villain to outplay him deeper in the hand on turns and rivers. Alright, so let's see what the turn card is. Let's take a turn. Turn play. Flop was queen, 9-2, rainbow. Villain c-bet, and we floated the flop. The turn is the jack of spades. Villain checks the hero. What does hero do? Okay, so now we've got ace of spades, king of spades, queen of spades, jack of spades. Villain checks. Now what? So do we want to check back? You have two overcards, a gut shot, and the nut flush draw. Taking a free card off would definitely be a high EV play. But we floated the flop to steal this pot, and our opponent checked. We should tend towards a bet here. Also, we are drawn to the nuts here, and our implied odds are high versus the part of villain's range that might actually call us. Checking is pretty weak here. It also gives villain a chance to bluff the river or make a hand that won't fold. Bet. We have poor showdown value and very high equity when called. Those are two main ingredients. Those are the two main ingredients for a good bluff. Villain tends to continuation bet one and done. We have no real showdown value. We have plenty of equity if we get called, and we have implied odds with our nut draws if we do get called. About pot size bet should be good here. Okay, so we bet pot. We bet 60 into 57. We called pre-flop with ace of spades, king of spades, and went heads up to a flop of queen 9-2. Villain c-bet, a c-bet on a board. A c-bet on that board is just about mandatory and doesn't mean very much. We called to steal it on the turn. We improved our equity with the jack of spades. He checks, we bet, he folds, easy game. Okay, and summary. The main takeaways from this hand are, pay attention, play spots not hands, don't play fit or fold like a big old puss. Alright guys, so that's the end of this presentation. I know it's kind of a shorter video. Maybe that's good, maybe that's bad. But really what I wanted to get was some input on this this format of instructional video. But even more, I'd like to know what your thoughts are. Put them in the comments. Let me know what you're thinking about this. I would be possibly willing to put together like a very long and involved and, complicated version of this that would be, you know, right from the very first hand of a tournament till the very last hand of the tournament, with kind of a choose-your-own-adventure style going through it, where every decision point you make is going to take you in one direction, but if you keep making good decisions, then eventually maybe you win the tournament, something like that. So thoughts would be appreciated. Hope you enjoyed the video. Hope you enjoyed the concept overall. Please do let me know what you think about it. Until next time, namaste poker homies.